Well, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this workshop, this panel presentation and discussion on what should be a very timely subject for all of you. We're really very happy to see you here, knowing that there's a lot of competition with other activities in the house. We're going to focus today on looking at the environmental goods agreement, and particularly beyond 2016, how do we optimize the potential of the agreement to support global value chains in clean technologies. My name is Ricardo Melendez Ortiz. I know many of you, and I'm very pleased to welcome you to this event, which is a partnership with the permanent mission of Finland in Geneva and the SETI Alliance, the Sustainable Energy Trade Initiatives Alliance, actually a business platform to support EGA negotiations and advocacy towards robust markets and frameworks for robust markets in specifically clean energy technologies. So I'd like to introduce you first to Ambassador Teri Hakala. Give them the floor to Ambassador Hakala for some remarks, and then I'll pick it up from there, and we can then continue to the panel. Two quick sort of housekeeping remarks. One is that we will be recording the proceedings of the panel, but not of the discussion. We will not be webcasting live today, but it will be posted in the internet and accessible to everybody after the panel. So we'll take the time to go through the presentations very quickly, and then we have built in the agenda a good space of time for a good discussion. But I'll do as I said before. I'll turn first the floor to Ambassador Hakala. Thank her again for the cooperation. You have the floor, Ambassador.
Thank you. Thank you. Excellencies, dear colleagues, and all participants, a warm welcome to you also on my behalf, on my mission's behalf, to this afternoon meeting, and it's a real pleasure for me to address you today on this very, very important topic and timely topic. And it's not a coincidence that we are organizing this event in the margins of the 17th round of negotiations for the Environmental Goods Agreement. While Finland is represented in these negotiations by the European Union, European Commission, as you know, we are fully committed and very hopeful of achieving an ambitious EGA agreement by the end of this year. Time is very short, so we should not lose a minute of time. And that's why I hope this event will also contribute to an ambitious outcome. The EGA is an opportunity not only for enhancing international trade, but also for contributing to a more sustainable future. After the international landmark agreements on sustainable development goals, the SDGs, and climate change last year, trade is the key policy area missing from an overarching international framework on sustainable development. And trade will certainly have an impact. Lowering tariffs of clean energy and energy-efficient products is a crucial first step that will help tackle climate change and support sustainable economic growth. But Finland also places emphasis on barriers beyond tariffs. As many clean energy technologies are produced in global value chains, they are also very much affected by various non-tariff barriers, ranging from cumbersome and divergent standards to a lacking of financing. And even if products could cross borders without barriers, many services directly linked to these products, such as assembly and repair, meet severely restricted market access. Finland has recently aligned itself with the SETI Alliance, a multi-stakeholder coalition of green energy technology companies, governments, research institutions, and intergovernmental organizations. Finland is very supportive of its objectives to enable the development and deployment of clean energy technologies so as to combat climate change, strengthen sustainable energy security, and create green growth through free trade and open markets. The Finnish government is committed to work closely with our private sector and encourage them to join as well. In fact, Finland has a great number of different clean tech companies that provide innovative and top-of-the-line solutions in areas ranging from renewables and energy efficiency to marine clean tech, oil and soil remediation, clean water supply and sanitation, and environmental monitoring. We will hold the Arctic Council presidency, including the Arctic Economic Council presidency, starting next year, and will work coherently and consistently to promote Arctic and marine clean tech solutions and trade also in that forum. We are also global leaders with regard to the bioeconomy and circular economy, creating new sustainable products and solutions. I hope this event will serve its purpose on shedding light on some non-tariff barriers along the value chain and some key drivers based on interventions from industry representatives and drawing on recent research. The main objective is to inform the EGA negotiations as they hopefully run to a close and to draw the attention of negotiators to possible future steps for the EGA. We are very optimistic in Finland about the potential provided by the EGA and hope this event will contribute to a positive momentum here within the walls of the WTO and beyond, among the global clean tech industry that is providing practical environmental solutions on the ground. I hope you have a fruitful meeting today. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Ambassador Hakala, and again, thank you for partnering with us on this subject and for your support to the SETI Alliance as well. Just very briefly on context, you all probably know how environmental goods negotiations were launched in Geneva about 2.5 years ago, in early 2004, that is. Was it 2003? 14. No, sorry, I said 14. I'm sorry. 2014. Thank you, Ingrid. In the run-up to that, we ICTSD have been engaged in trying to understand, particularly the relationship between energy supply and climate change. In our journey, trying to, again, have a comprehensive understanding not only of energy supply and climate change, but how trade policy would affect or not a transition to low carbon economy and to a greener economy, what we have found was that indeed there were barriers to the expansion of clean energy technology. And by that, what we have been focusing on is that the technological development in the area of clean energy, the manufacturing, the deployment, and the use of clean energy technologies. We have also found out that beyond climate change, clean energies could contribute to satisfying a growing demand on energy worldwide. Last week, some of us were at the World Energy Council. The latest estimates talk about a growth in demand of about 50% between now and 2040 in energy. That demand will come largely from developing countries. It will have to include addressing the question of energy poverty, which deals not only with access and affordability to modern forms of energy, but also with providing sufficient energy for development. And so this is the context on which we have put the work that we have done on clean energy. We are cognizant about the fact that the environmental goods negotiations go beyond clean energy, but we would like to focus today particularly on that question of clean energy and look at how those technologies, again, are produced and put together for the delivery of energy in international markets in the context of a globalized economy. The environmental goods agreement negotiations involving 44 members of this House, which is not an insignificant number, also by looking at their participation in those markets, specifically again on the clean energy markets, will contribute by reducing tariffs, a first step really in addressing the kind of barriers that we're looking at. Tariffs in a global value chain world are important, and you know this in this House very well, not least because even nuisance tariffs, tariffs below 5% or less, in a context where components and goods cross borders multiple times, become a cost that make then production less efficient. It also, in a very big way, determines who participates in markets in when you're dealing with very highly competitive technologies again. So even though last year and this year have been record years on investment in clean energy technologies, and we have seen the cost of generating electricity with clean energy technologies gone down in a dramatic fashion in the past few years, we continue to record a really enormous effort to really to bring in clean energy technologies to energy supply so that they will really have an effect on addressing climate change particularly. It is estimated that, again, if we go in a business as usual scenario, from what the kind of composition of energy supply that we have globally, into addressing that growth in demand towards 2050, we will certainly not meet the targets for climate change and for the stabilization of climate that have been agreed in the Paris Agreement. So the concluding negotiations on environmental goods agreement is important. It is a first step towards making these technologies more efficient, more affordable, allowing the participation of more countries in their production, and as well as allowing the use of more countries of these technologies. This comes, this conclusion of negotiations at this stage come very nicely, if you like, in the tail of the conclusion of the Paris Agreement, now ready for ratification and implementation, as well as the Sustainable Development Goals that were agreed last year, where again energy has been highlighted as a priority, particularly when it comes to the question of addressing energy poverty. So for all those reasons, those negotiations are important from that clean energy technology perspective. However, they are insufficient to address very important barriers still, both to the entry of many to those markets, as well as to barriers for the participation in a global value chain world particularly. Those barriers have to do with a number of issues for which we have tools in trade policy, issues like local content requirements, issues like, for instance, addressing the very important question of embedded and associated services with technologies to deliver clean energy, as well as the questions related to energy efficiency and the use in the context of a world in which we're expecting that about 75% of energy demand will continue to be satisfied with fossil fuel subsidies, even of lower carbon content like gas, there is the question of how do you maximize and optimize then the combination of technologies so that you can really move towards, again, a zero carbon or that lower carbon targets that we're all looking for. So what we're going to do today is look at presentations that first will give us an idea of how is it that clean energy technologies are produced in value chains in global markets. For that, we will use research that we have commissioned with Dr. Vina Jam, and she would start with that presentation. We will move to looking into the question of services, and for that, again, we will work with our colleague Johannes Bernabe, who is also known for to many of you here. And then we will have two industry presentations. One, and I'll give a bit of that context when we get there, by Varko Vajnike, who is director at Wärtsilä, one of the largest companies, and a Finnish company invited by the mission to look at a systems approach to environmental technology trade from their perspective and their experience in the, again, interface between lower carbon technologies such as gas and clean energy technologies. And then we will finish with a presentation by Jody Russell from Trina Solar, one of the leading companies in the world in the production of solar energy technologies, looking at the contribution of solar to delivering the commitments that countries have made in the Paris Agreement. So with that, let me turn the floor to the first presentation by Vina. Vina, you have the floor.
What's happening?
You probably have to.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very pleased to be here to talk to you people about the drivers and barriers in clean energy value chains. This was research commissioned by the ICTSD as outlined by Ricardo, but I would especially like to acknowledge the contribution of Mr. René Vosna, who's sitting here, and also Trina Solar, which was Jody, who was, she gave a lot of inputs to the study, which was of great value. So basically, if we look at the industry, competition in this industry is really fierce, and it is the improvements in technology are not just incremental, they are great leaps of improvements in technology and performance. Prices are dropping, and domestic policy incentives are crucial because they support local growth in both manufacturing and deployment. Now, the supply chain has several possibilities of entry for different kinds of countries, whether you manufacture or you don't. And the most important thing is that trade is a big driver. You know, and countries which do not deploy renewable energy also have participated in the trading system as such. So trade is kind of independent from deployment in some cases. In most cases, it's linked to deployment, but some countries have taken the lead and they have gone ahead and traded even when they did not deploy it. And in that sense, you know, trade has really driven down prices and made these technologies accessible. And EGA negotiations in that sense would be very important. So I'll start with the of a global solar energy and solar PV modules. As you can see from this chart, that this is the growth in this industry is extremely sensitive to domestic policy. When a country pulls back its support policy, there is a drop in demand, and the country is then forced either to export to international markets, or it is forced to cut down, or you know, the inventories grow. So I'm just giving five examples of the top countries in the solar field. I mean, in China, for example, there was a drop in 2016 demand because of the FIT, the feed-in tariff pullback. In US ITC extension of the production credits, production tax exemptions actually led to 120% increase in demand. In Japan, scaling back FIT support led to 12% drop in demand. In UK, a 65% FIT pullback led to a 64% decrease in demand. And in India, support policy, especially of auctioning and tendering, has led to a huge increase in demand. This is the solar supply chain, and I don't know whether it's very clear to you from your seats, but what I can tell you is that the green portion is the services portion of the supply chain, and the blue portion is the manufacturing portion of the supply chain. And in the solar industry, roughly 60% of the total value added comes from the services portion of the supply chain. The importers and exporters, I've only taken solar photovoltaics, but there are many other components and many other services also which are traded. Interestingly, as you can see over here from this table, these are the top importers and exporters. This is an average figure of 2012 to 2015. As you can see, amongst the top, the left column is the exporters and the right column are the importers. Sorry, I couldn't fit all that in the PowerPoint. So, as you can see, Malaysia, one should take with a pinch of salt, because Malaysia's exports are mostly LEDs. They are not solar photovoltaics. The HS code includes LEDs, and we have trade only in terms of the HS code. So here, most of it is PVs, solar PVs, but there's also LEDs. As you can see, it's very important to observe that the left-hand countries and the right-hand countries are very similar. That is, countries tend to import cheaper PVs to employ and export more expensive PVs. And that is something that is quite interesting to observe. The patterns are basically, as you can see, the high-cost producers such as Japan, Korea, and Germany and US are also major exporters, just as China, Hong Kong, and other Asian countries are major exporters. So both low-cost exporters and high-cost exporters tend to dominate the scene. Then successfully building the domestic PV industry is very loosely related to domestic deployment. That is, countries which are exporting are not necessarily those which are high on domestic deployment. And it's quite interesting to observe that a lot of the industry developed in response to the fits in Europe. And the incentives actually drove exports, because the country started seeking PVs and the prices started plummeting when trade was when these were virtually at zero tariffs. Then, as I told you earlier, that a lot of countries import cheap modules and export expensive modules. And the large manufacturers actually they have typically supply chains that span several countries, and they tend to import the same component as well from many suppliers simultaneously. One important trade opportunity which is missing in this is, missing in the EGA negotiations is the services, particularly financial and consultancy services, which is a very important component of it. But I'm sure you'll hear a lot more about that from Johannes. In terms of wind energy, as you can see, most of the countries that have installed worldwide capacity and in their domestic markets, this is a little different from the solar case, they are the ones who have become very prominent in the exporting and importing side. In the wind energy supply chain, everything from project development onwards is a supply side, and is the services side, and raw materials to component manufacturing to assembly is the manufacturing part of the total value chain. In terms of the value chain in wind, it's a little different from solar. 68% of the total value is actually from the manufacturing itself. You know, it's from the turbine, it's actually the turbine costs. And the rest is services. So most countries tend to import turbines. There are very few countries which actually manufacture or assemble them. The numbers are growing. But at this point of time, as I showed you in the last slide, there are a few countries who dominate the manufacturing. top exporters and importers, I mean, not surprisingly, a lot are from the EU, but because EU was the first to have the targets on renewable energy, so a lot of deployment started locally. But also other countries which are coming into the scene are Mexico, and you know, Japan, of course, has been important. And in the importing side, it gives us a very good indication of which are the countries which are starting deployment, you know. And so that is a very interesting observation, because most of the countries which are on the importing side are those which are at the beginning of their solar wind energy deployment. As I said earlier, this is different from the solar industry, because domestic deployment is very important. And interestingly, exports of wind energy equipment follow a pattern that has really followed localization. That is, a lot of the exporters have used LCRs in the past. Some continue to use them. And a lot of them have a high degree of localization, upwards of 70% of localization in the parts. Except in Latin America, so far regional trade has played a very important part, because these wind parts are very large and the transport costs can be high. In some countries, it accounts for as high as 30% of the total costs. So trading follows a hub pattern, where you have development of regional hubs, where the import of components and the export of wind turbines is set in these hubs. The new entrants to the market are South Africa, Chile, and Uruguay, and they figure very importantly on the import side. And most of their installed capacity was really added in the last 2-3 years. India and Japan used to be large exporters, but don't figure anymore as large exporters. And the reason is that a lot of the support policies had to be dropped. There is a predominance of intra-European trade, and as I said, regional trade is very important. And what is also important over here is that tradable components do not compete on price alone, but they are based on an identification of the niches in which the domestic industry is most likely to compete. For example, Japan competes on AC generators, but it doesn't compete on all parts of this value chain. So each country has to find its own sweet spot where it can compete, and it specializes in that sweet spot. And their competition is not merely on the basis of price, but it is also based on quality considerations, the resistance, the climatic variations that the blades can adopt to, and many other conditions that are important. There is a growing trade in services in the RE sector. For example, turbine design, wind assessment, project development, and financing. These are some of the services that are increasingly traded internationally. And there is also an emerging trend to combine services and equipment trade. And the notable examples in this are China and India, which actually offer turnkey solutions that combine project development, project financing, and also the supply of equipment. These are the incentives that have been provided by governments as part of the renewable energy generation deployment and deployment scheme. As you can see, a lot of them are subsidies, some of which may actually be WTO inconsistent, some may be WTO consistent. But it's important to observe that a number of countries have given these incentives. And in most cases, they are either in the nature of a subsidy, or they are local content requirements. Local content requirements can be implemented in two ways. It can actually be a local content demand for a certain amount of percentage of the total manufacturing to be done on board, or also for the auctions, there can be a condition that only firms which have a certain percentage of local content can bid. There can also be local content requirements for government loans. So, for example, countries can only avail of government loans if they have a certain percentage of local content. And the state of California and Brazil are very good examples of these kinds of local content requirements. So in a strictly, and some of it, of course, is for government procurement only. So strictly speaking, local content is a very gray area because we don't know which of them would fall foul of the GATT and which would not in the TRIMS agreement. Oops. Now, how can EGA benefit RE supply chain participation? There are a lot of items which are not included, services, and especially the downstream services, which I showed you in the diagrams. They are very important, highly tradable. Every country has the capacity to develop parts of it, and every country has some capacity to trade in this service. Then also, it's important to note that the fastest growing imports for RE are actually outside the EGA region. That is, the EGA countries are exporting to non-EGA countries, and this is true of both solar and wind. Now, some countries which have shrinking domestic markets are, like China and Spain. These are, in the case of wind and in the case of solar, these have become large exporters, but most of the exports are also to non-EGA countries. Wind turbines and blades, and today I was informed that towers and masts are also included, so I have a little outdated information here. But wind turbines, blades, and hubs are included in the EGA list. Towers and masts, I'm told, are also included. So as far as the goods are concerned, most of the goods that we have mentioned in the supply chain would be included. In most countries, tariffs are not a major issue because tariffs are low, very low for solar and wind products. Cumulative tariffs can sometimes be important, maybe in Asia, but it is much less so in Africa and Latin America. And even without complete liberalization schemes, countries do have schemes in place, such as duty drawback, which is related to the import of components for RE, where actually everything is de facto imputed duty-free. So the basic issue is that most of these products which I have listed are actually at zero tariffs. Even cumulatively, tariffs are not that important. They could be in some cases, but in most cases, they are not. Then, what are the major barriers then? The non-tariff measures are major barriers: subsidies, LCRs, anti-dumping, standards, and government procurement. You know, these are some of the issues that need to be looked at because they could be the major barriers that are emerging, and they could be the major barriers in future for trade in RE goods and services. But it has to be understood that the cost reduction has mostly come on account of trade liberalization, and this will be further strengthened by the EGA negotiations. And we do hope that with the EGA negotiations, some other prices would come down, especially of things like ball bearings, etc., which some countries have higher tariffs on. And this would particularly benefit the new and emerging RE economies. So thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for your attention.
Thank you, Vina. That was a very... That's a presentation that has been giving us a lot of elements and food for thought to move forward. Now I'll turn to Johannes, and Johannes has the challenge of talking about services, which hasn't been part of the EGA negotiations. It's been discussed somewhere else in the House, but which in the case of particularly clean energy technologies is a critical element. So Johannes, please.
Thank you, Ricardo. I have an obvious bias for services because I was a negotiator for the Philippines 15 years until around 10 years ago, dealing with GATS back in the day when the Doha round and the GATS negotiations were very much part of the talk of the town. Now, insofar as the EGA negotiations are concerned, over the last 3 years, ICTSD and E15 have been consistently advocating an enhanced understanding of the critical role that services could and would play in mobilizing the goods that would be liberalized in relation to the environmental imperative. Now, as basis for the presentation I will make, there are basically three sources. One is a initial set of findings we have on a case study on services that was undertaken together with Patrick Lowe and Joya Brenica a couple of years back or a year ago. And this looks at the services that would be required as part of the value chain in generating wind power in the Philippines. Now, we looked at one particular firm, but one would assume that this is replicated across the board. Second, as I mentioned earlier, refers to discussions and some reflections that members in the A15 had in the context of sessions on clean energy. And third is, if I may modestly offer some experience of my own as legal counsel and as equity owner in some renewable energy projects in the Philippines. What is obvious and what Vina has already started to impart is the criticality of services as a necessary complement to the liberalization of trade in environmental goods. For you to be able to scale up trade in energy, in clean energy, services are indispensable because they are inherently part of the value chain. Vina had shown in some flowchart earlier where services becomes quite important and indispensable. And in our own little study, what we did was break down what would pertain to pre-generation, secondly, generation, third is transmission, and fourth is distribution of renewable energy using wind power. The coverage of the services we looked at, or the coverage of the value chain we looked at, pertain mostly to post-establishment or post-installation of the wind turbines. But even in the pre-generation stage, and talking in the context of the survey we did with the wind power generating facility, what was fairly obvious is that before you can set up the wind turbines, the wind towers, there's a lot of services involved. As it were, the wind turbines, the towers, will not assemble themselves out of the box, even if tariffs were reduced to zero. In terms of, for instance, just finding out where to locate the towers or the wind turbines, there's a great deal of wind mapping or wind assessment services that are involved. For instance, in the case of the Philippines, this was done not by local expertise, if you will, but through a Japan-funded assessment of where the wind corridors are and where it would be proper or most optimal to locate the wind towers. Obviously, there's a lot of research and development which is involved in the design and engineering phase of the wind facility. And construction, although one would imagine that it can be fairly localized, would still benefit from expertise which is probably not as local as one would imagine, because those obviously who have more experience in setting up wind towers would be in a better position to advise the locals who would do the grunt work in terms of the construction of these wind towers. Vina made mention of project financing, and if I could just make mention of this. While there has been a great deal of financing thrown in the way of climate mitigation and climate adaptation, and there's been substantial financing supposedly made available for financing renewable energy projects, what normally has happened, at least in the context of our jurisdiction, is that these get trapped in the national development banks simply because there's no expertise in properly assessing and evaluating applications for financing and renewable energy projects. So the money is there, but what has happened is we have had to secure the expertise of foreign bank account officers who have the necessary expertise to assess the kind of risks, the kind of collateralization and securities that can be properly accepted for granting credit for renewable energy projects. As I mentioned earlier, when we looked at this value chain in so far as the wind facility in the Philippines are concerned, we basically focused on the post-establishment of the facilities, and that would pertain to generation, transmission, and distribution. And of course, I added here grid management for a couple of reasons I'll get to later. Vina has made mention of the fact that generally, and if I heard it correctly, around 60% of the costs of generating and transmitting these renewable energy would pertain to services. We have varying numbers when we conducted the survey, but suffice it to say that two outstanding service activities which leapt out at us pertain to operations and maintenance. Operations and maintenance covers all manners of sin, as it were. But for instance, imagine when you have wind turbines functioning, but in need of regular service. And given the height of the infrastructure that you have created, you would obviously need cranes to specifically service this, and crane operators with some degree of expertise in actually cleaning and maintaining these wind turbines to ensure that bugs, that grease, that even some wind transferred pollutants are properly taken out of the functioning of the wind turbines. The other important service, which sometimes is not made available, especially in developing countries, is reinsurance schemes, again, as part of financing services or financial services. In this particular wind facility that we looked at, located in the northern part of the Philippines, reinsurance was, in fact, the biggest cost component for ensuring that the wind turbine facility, the RE facility, was properly functioning. Not because it related to actually making the wind turbines work, but because it offered them that degree of security which would allow them to maintain a credit line with financing institutions. In terms of transmission and distribution, and perhaps this is a proper segue into this table, where we list all the different services entering the supply chain, the most significant item here in terms of cost was again on maintenance in terms of transmission. Maintenance because the transmission lines owned by the wind generating facility would have to travel something like 57 kilometers to reach the main grid. And to the extent that it does traverse isolated areas, and maybe in a particularly unique local context, there is some danger in terms of certain individuals or certain entities trying to perhaps tamper or steal certain components that go into the infrastructure related to transmission, maintenance is a particular cost-intensive service. Now, in terms of a word on the grid management and the automatic dispatch, in the Philippines, there is obviously just one grid servicing Luzon and Visayas, which, if you will, are the main consumption centers for electricity. The kind of grid management service that has been put in place, again, requires foreign know-how or expertise, if you will, which at that time that it was set up was not locally available. The kind of automatic dispatch sensors that needed to be put in place also needed to benefit from a liberalized perspective on this service. So indeed, verily, the preliminary value chain studies that we conducted or surveys show that mostly services are required in the post-investment phase of the operation of wind generating facilities. And maybe just a word to get back to this stage one and stage two, where we looked at the post-installation generation and the transmission phase. Another aspect which probably needs highlighting is the item on logistics services and consultancy services. Consultancy services, not only in terms of getting the wind turbines up, but actually in the course of actual generation. There are a lot of expertises required for this, which would also benefit from a liberalized or a more open perspective, if you will, on services trade. And logistics also, because in terms of providing all the necessary inputs for keeping the wind turbines running, you would need transport services, you would need telecommunication services as necessary inputs for these to function efficiently. Now, obviously, there are a number of challenges which abound. One, of course, relates to the classification issue in services. What exactly are covered in terms of the kind of services that need to be further reviewed and liberalized? There have been a number of proposals in years past, one of which was the Indonesian proposal on energy services, which adopted a more or less cluster-based approach. It categorized the kind of energy services required according to upstream, downstream, and energy commercialization services. Now, that hasn't really taken a lot of traction, and in a way, perhaps, it goes to the issue of the duality of use of certain services. How do you make a distinction, for instance, between services which are geared towards renewable energy services and services which are more likely to be consumed in conventional energy generation or transmission? On this regard, it might be useful, for instance, to see how it is possible to carve out those related services specific to environment and renewable energy. For instance, if you look at Cambodia and Indonesia's commitments on consultancy services, this makes specific reference to a relationship with energy. And one would surmise that it is possible to further bifurcate this into perhaps targeting specifically renewable energy services. Other issues relate to regulation. Oftentimes, when you look at value chains, even if you attain a situation where you have sufficiently liberalized tariffs, it is the licensing requirements or the standards which are necessary for you to be able to integrate into the value chain which become problematic. Another critical aspect of looking at liberalization of trade and services for purposes of renewable energy would be competition issues, in the sense that essential facilities, for instance, the grid, which transmits and distributes energy generated by renewable energy facilities, are oftentimes subject of a monopolized entity, then the question arises of the extent to which you can impose significant market power obligations to ensure that there are other generating entities, particularly RE entities, which could have facilitated access to the grid. There are also issues with regard to possible collusive practices of local service suppliers who have already entrenched themselves and are in a certain situation able to capture the regulators. How are these addressed as an adjunct to liberalization of trade and services? And then, of course, on a very practical matter, for instance, in relation to the financing which is required for a lot of these RE projects, it is the on-the-ground competence of financial institutions which would need to be shored up through the provision of perhaps Mode 4 or technical experts coming from jurisdictions which have had more experience in RE. A number of options may be looked at. Of course, this is probably something which is more forward-looking, but talk has been made mention before in other fora of possible reference paper for renewable energy services. Such a renewable energy services reference paper, for instance, is something that would include core elements such as third-party access to essential facilities, transparency obligations, and independent regulation. also one can look at the GATS reference papers for guidance on this, and it could be similar to the approach taken for the EGA negotiations, something that can be agreed on plurilaterally and maybe subsequently applied multilaterally. There could also be a sectorial approach, albeit recognizing the difficulty of having a confluence of the required energy and the services that would make up this mix of what would constitute the sector. This builds, of course, on the notion that it is very difficult to segregate goods vis-a-vis services when you are talking about renewable energy. And this is why, for instance, in a practical matter, India and China, and we have seen this translated into RE projects in the Philippines, have gone on a turnkey approach or modality. This sectorial approach could also take care of the classification issue I alluded to earlier, in the sense that rather than simply having an enumeration and listing of committed services, such a sectorial approach can have a descriptive approach, similar to the GATS understanding on financial services. Now, other options in terms of moving forward relate to perhaps standstill binding of commitments in terms of certain services which are indispensable to the provision of RE generation and transmission. There could be, because of the reference to possible WTO inconsistent subsidies which are being granted even as we speak, perhaps a waiver or an authoritative interpretation under the WTO rules to allow green subsidies in the WTO so as to avoid possible disputes in this regard. In closing, there are a mix or a variety of possible menus to look at and to select from in terms of trying to ensure that services are liberalized alongside the EGA in terms of ensuring that when these renewable energy goods are more freely liberalized in terms of trade between countries, that these would have the necessary, the critical element of services which would allow them to be properly set up for generation, distribution, and transmission. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Johannes. That was a bit long but comprehensive. And again, it's an issue that even we have been going through it for so many years here, we're still really to see some negotiations, initiatives to break ground, to move ahead on those issues. And as you heard, from a perspective of delivering clean energy services is absolutely essential. So we look forward to reforming that on those issues as well. Now let me turn to Marco Vainike. And as I mentioned before, Marco is going to talk about an issue that we think is quite interesting in that dealing with the question of energy efficiency, which is a critical component, if you like, of decarbonization as well as that transition to better energy systems. In doing that, he's going to focus on his company's experience in optimizing renewable energy systems, including gas turbines. Now, the question of, in the ICTSD work, and particularly in the SETI Alliance, we have focused mostly on clean energy technologies and have not looked at lower carbon fuels such as gas. However, again, in the context of what we're facing going forward and thinking about the work we need to do ahead on trade policy, it is important to look at these issues, and we think at this time. Carbon has been part of the discussions in the EGA. Gas turbines are in the list of APIC environmental goods that has served as a basis to build the negotiations on EGAs. And again, the question of being very real as when it comes to what is next is what also we find that is very important here. So why don't we listen then to Marco, who would probably give us a very real world perspective rather than the policy aspects that we're more used to discuss here. Marco, please.
Thank you very much for this opportunity. And as I said, that I will try to bring a little bit different approach for the discussion. And I must now highlight right in the beginning that I'm going to talk about a little bit gas engines, not turbines, and this is an important step for Wärtsilä. Since we have a three business line, it's a Finnish-based company. We have an energy solution business and a marine solution and then related services. And in the energy sector, we are providing turnkey power plants or equipment for the power plants based on the engines. But today also hybrid power plants together with solar panels. In marine solution, we cover everything starting from the ship design, including the engine, the propulsion lines and technologies, environmental technologies, electrical automation, and etc. And of course, the services are related to both of these businesses, but we also operate the plants on behalf of our customers. So we operate and maintain them whenever the customer requires that. And we have thousands of megawatts of plants operated by Wärtsilä. And today we employ more or less 19,000 people worldwide. We have a network of companies in 70 countries, so our purpose is to be close to our customers. But at the same time, we have delivered our solutions more than 180 countries, so we could say that our business is truly global. We have a huge supply chain, thousands of key suppliers, and if you take all the indirect included, then it's more or less tens of thousands of suppliers. And typically, if we have a turnkey project in one specific country, we would also like to utilize the local workforce there as much as possible. But of course, the expertise lies in our expert centers, where we then bring the knowledge for these projects. And finally, thinking about the strategic growth areas of Wärtsilä, we see three elements here at the bottom of the slide: the energy efficient solutions, gas-based technologies, and innovative solutions. And it was mentioned today earlier by a Finnish ambassador that Finland is a very much clean tech orientated country, and I could say that Wärtsilä is one of the biggest clean tech companies in Finland. So I try to bring the insights that we are seeing in our business. We have faced that both the marine sector and the power sector are going to the decarbonization roadmap, and that requires lots of changes the way the things has been done in the past and how they should be done in the future. And we have a one common nominator, which will be the gas in the transition period. And we have seen that engine technology can maximize the integration of the renewables, and also it can lead to the shipping sector to increase its environmental performance in very, very big way, more or less. So I'm going to tackle a little bit these, but of course some elements which concerns also the environmental goods agreement process. We have in Wärtsilä started to think that if we think about the environmental aspects or impacts of the products on different way, we will get different results. And typically companies are looking at their environmental impact through the life cycle approach, seeing that what's happening during the life cycle of the one product, and then making, let's say, some improvement plans, and even comparing different products and seeing that which one is the better. And that's quite fine. But that gives us a limited, let's say, insight what is the true value of the product after all. And therefore, we have also started to look these issues on end user point of view, seeing that what is the end user, what sort of technologies the end user is needing. but also on the system level, that if we have solutions which can be utilized on the system level, how much value does it bring to the whole system? And I think that it's difficult to get the insights right now, but I try to elaborate that a bit during the presentation, and I hope that you also start to think that if you have a list of products, that is it the product itself or what the product can bring to the wider good. But I start with the end user perspective. Wärtsilä started to develop the dual fuel technology in late 90s, I suppose. The time was not ready for the shipping sector at that time, but later in the early 2000, the industry was ready to take this new technology in use, and that happened in LNG carriers. The LNG carriers in the past utilized very old technology using another fuel to run the ship and the cargo, which always generate some boil of gas, was released more or less into the atmosphere. And then we developed a technology which utilized the boil of gas as a fuel for the vessel and introduced that to the market. And after the introduction, all the LNG carriers selected this technology, and we calculated that the 51st LNG carriers, when they utilized these new technologies, were able to reduce the CO2 emissions by 2 million tons per year. And thinking our own operational CO2 emissions, for example, we are approximately in the level of 100,000 tons per year. So it's a remarkable improvement through this thinking of what the end customer is needing. And here you can see also what other benefits the gas can provide for the shipping sector. The aviation is now have agreed some sort of scheme to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions, but in the shipping sector there are also the traditional emissions like the nitrogen oxides, the sulfur dioxides and the particulates. And by switching the fuel, the shipping sector will improve its environmental performance a lot, as you can see from the pictures. So the traditional emissions drops nearly to the zero level, and then there is an improvement potential for the greenhouse gases as well. Unfortunately, today, only 0.1% of the global fleet of the vessels are utilizing this gas opportunity. So the improvement potential is huge. And thinking about these traditional emissions, EU makes some estimates that the shipping sector is now contributing more or less as much traditional emissions than the whole land-based sources together. So it's a very big issue, and this is a quite simple improvement potential that you would get rid of the traditional emissions, but also you are able to help in the decarbonization work. So therefore we need that this is an important element for the shipping sector to utilize the gas as a transition fuel, and then of course there is a room for other fuels as well or other sources when they are available. But we see that this is a mature technology and that can be utilized right away. Then thinking about the power systems, the renewables has been discussed a lot. And we in Wärtsilä believe that we are enablers of the renewable integration. So we can help the power systems to utilize more and more the renewables and make it reliable, sustainable and also affordable, so that all the elements are in some place, in same place or package. And what has happened in the power systems, the development from the past and what we are going in the future, it's totally different system, more or less. In the past, the capacity was low, it was meant all the power plants were more or less designed to produce as much energy as they can. And the load, from transmission system operator point of view, was predictable. They knew the consumer behavior, they knew when they need more power and when they need less power. And they could then quite easily to give the signals for the power producers that now you have to slow down or now you have to ramp up. But when the renewables are coming more and more in the picture, there will be intermittent capacity, which means that there will be some fluctuations. And then the net load is also changing a little bit, because when the renewables are in, then the other capacities need to go down. And the more we have in the future, the more fluctuations we will also have. And that will change the way the power systems are operating, and that's pretty much brings in new capabilities which are needed to run the power system in an efficient way. And here we have technologies which can help in this integration. The engines, you can see here in the picture, this is the release from the last year. This is the most efficient engine in the world. It's a medium speed engine. Very latest technologies. Efficiency is more than 50%, and the emissions are extremely low with this technology. But what are the capabilities that these gas engines can provide for the power system is we have the high part load efficiency, meaning that when we are the modular, we could have more or less 10 units. When there's a need for the part load, we can then switch off the units one by one and remain very high on the efficiency ratio. Modularity also means that if you have a need for flexible power, you can install it a certain amount, and it's easy to add up more units, so you don't have to make an investment which is oversized or which is too little, more or less. But the key feature is the rapid start up and shutdown. You know the modern cars, when you go to the traffic lights, the engine stop. And when you need to go forward, it's start again. And the same elements are more or less in the bigger and more efficient engines, that when the wind is going down or there are changes in the solar output, then engines can come in and balance the needed power. And when they are not needed, they can be shut down. And that doesn't generate any emissions. So we have a saying, internal saying, that we provide the best value when the engines are not run. So it means that all the renewables can do their share. And if you don't have that flexibility, then the other technologies will take the share of the total output. It means that there is a wind curtailment or whatsoever, and you are not utilizing the technology as much as you could, more or less. So the benefits, there are many. It's a beneficial for the decarbonization, but also for the total power system. So we are able to maximize the utilization. So we run only when needed, and then we are shutting down. We can reduce the generation cost because, as you can see here in the picture, now I selected the wrong button here. You see in the picture, I'm afraid of pushing now again. But if there are any baseload plants, they can run on their optimal level. And they don't have to take part of these cyclic operations, which then reduces the efficiency and generates more emissions. And here is the system optimization part. Then, of course, the balancing the wind and solar, it also increases the reliability for the system, which is a very crucial element in many places. And finally, the fuel flexibility. We are talking about the gas engines, but the gas engine technology can also run biogases or biofuels if they are available. It's the same product, utilizing different fuels. And therefore, just talking about the gas engines is not the best way of describing it, but unfortunately, we don't have anything else in this EGA framework. So it's a huge issue that you have various fuels that you can utilize, also from security of supply point of view. Then, there are case studies. This is the true survey done by DNV Chem. The state of California has a target to increase the renewable share to 33% by 2020. And they had also planned invest on open cycle gas turbines, which are here above, 5.5 gigawatts, just to compensate fluctuations. And in this survey, DNV Chem evaluated that if this new capacity would be replaced by gas engine technology, which is more flexible, more dynamic, in the, and have the capabilities that the system needs, what are the consequences to the system? And what they find out is that it will save $1 billion each year from money-wise. That's coming from the total system efficiency point of view. It will reduce the emissions 1.5 million tons per year. And also, in this case, it will save lots of water, because the water is a necessity, and it's very many areas are lacking of the fresh water. So these plants don't use water more or less at all. And what is the deal? Here is the other picture from California. In 20, this is the net load curve, which means that when you take the total load minus the renewables, what the other capacities need to do. And this is the day. Hours are here. So it means that every day the thermal capacity needs to go down when the sun starts to shine. And then when the sun is going to sleep, more or less, the thermal capacity needs to ramp up again. And the multitude, if you think about, is 14 gigawatts every day. It means 14,000 megawatts of electricity needs to go up and down. And it's a huge amount of energy, and it's a huge amount of capabilities that you need to have in order to secure that the utilization of the renewables are at the highest level. So one of the recent example, Wärtsilä announced a couple of weeks earlier that the city of Denton ordered a flexible gas generation plan from Wärtsilä engines, and their plan is to increase the share of renewables up to 70%, which means that they can skip the coal totally, and then they install a little bit our capacity, and that together will reduce the emissions by 78% through integration of renewables. And if there are cities like that, that the 70% is produced by renewables, it's quite high in also in a global basis. But okay, the time is running out, so my point here is that we should focus also thinking about the system value, not only the products, because the system value might be much bigger than the product-wise when you compare different products, and therefore also thinking about the future. In the marine sector and in the power sector, the engines should be included, gas engines, in the EGA framework. But then, some for the process purposes, I think that for the future, the EGA should of course reflect the latest innovations. Maybe we could also consider if the current HOAS code categorization is fit for the purpose, we would require an efficient review mechanisms. So, because there are innovations coming up, so every now and then, and as I said, the end user and system impact should be taken into account. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marco. Thank you very much, and thank you for keeping it to that question of energy efficiency in energy systems as well, and highlighting the importance that in order to really be effective in the contribution to the reduction of emissions, you need to tackle the efficiency side of energy supply as well. So I'll turn to Jody, and I'm sorry, Jody, that you're the last speaker and that we have been running very long on their presentations. So if I could ask you to be efficient, Jody is the chair of the current chairperson of the SETI Alliance. Jody, please.
Thank you, Ricardo. Given we have 15 minutes before we should close, how about I try to condense my remarks to 5 minutes, and let's see if I can quickly get through these slides so that some of you will have the opportunity for questions. I was going to speak about solar's capabilities today to assist nations in moving toward their nationally determined contributions in the Paris Agreement, and how the EGA, as well as other agreements that are currently under discussion, can contribute toward achieving those, to pull this together from a solar value chain perspective. So very briefly about my company, Trina, we're the largest manufacturer of solar panels in the world. You have some statistics about us up here. I won't read them. We're large. We have many large competitors as well, of about 15 companies that are operating in the industry as manufacturers at very significant economies of scale. About the Paris Agreement, we're in this happy period before it enters into force on the 4th of November, following passing the 55-country minimum ratification mark. As of yesterday on the UNFCCC website, we were at 81 countries who've ratified. So the good news is, if countries really move forward with their commitments, we should be able to hold temperature increases to 2 degrees. The bad news is, what if they can't achieve their commitments? Solar is leading the pack in terms of receiving investment in the past years. This is statistics from REN21 in their annual Renewables Global Status Report. Solar is doing well, but unfortunately, we don't see the type of investment in the other renewables technologies that we need to see. Because solar doesn't work in every situation, even if we have partners in gas load balancing, even if we have partners in solar storage, we actually need to see, for all countries to be able to achieve their targets, significant movement with other technologies. And there's a really significant gap in infrastructure investment. This slide shows it in two different ways. Investment in clean energy infrastructure here in billions, and then a look, this was originally prepared for a group of global pension funds, about 40 that the World Economic Forum is gently nudging toward looking at, why is it today, of the total asset investments disclosed, that less than 1% has been invested in sustainable energy infrastructure assets, when pension funds should be investing for the future? So the World Economic Forum is doing some good advocacy work educating there, but we have a structural problem if sovereign wealth funds and if pension funds are not investing. Here down below, you can see the 2030 requirements that were estimated at the COP21 in terms of the necessary investments. And here you can see the average investment per year over the past 2 years. We really need to make significant strides in asset investment in clean energy generation. On the solar side, you can see here levelized cost of energy, some updated data. This is from the end of 2015, no, sorry, first half of 2016 from Bloomberg New Energy Finance. And you'll see here in the blue dot is the benchmark kind of average price for different types of power generation. So you can see the tremendous progress that solar has made here, reducing its average costs against, for example, combined cycle generation, gas, and coal. Solar is competitive today, and this is competitive in an environment where the G20 provides 4 times more subsidies for fossil fuels than they do for clean energy technologies, over $440 billion a year. So when we talk about, Vina had made remarks about the impact of subsidization on clean energy technology. But remember, these are subsidies being removed from clean energy while fossil fuels continue to be subsidized at a very significant rate. So the good news, developing economies are now adopting clean energy at an even faster rate than developed countries have. And this change started in 2015. This is largely driven by economies of scale in manufacturing. Some of you joined the 3D virtual reality tour outside. You're welcome to come tour a solar factory in 7 minutes if you'd like afterwards. Now, looking at your discussions here, this is one of my last, this is the fifth to last slide in my attempt to preserve 10 minutes for Q&A. Solar Power Europe, the European Association, and we could see this as a stand-in for the most mature solar market in the world, did a very interesting study at the end of 2015 with Ernst & Young. And they looked at Europe as an example, as a mature market. Where are the jobs in goods and services, and where is the gross value added? So if we look at our value chain, which I'll go into detail in the next slide, the downstream is actually where 86% of the jobs are. Those are the service jobs. The upstream in manufacturing, only 14%. And here you can see the breakdown of what types of services jobs, like Johannes had referenced, engineering, studies, administration, installation jobs, and then operations and maintenance jobs. In the case of solar, those are jobs that are local and they go on for 25 to 30 years. The upstream jobs in manufacturing, again, only 14% of all jobs created by solar investments. If we look at gross value added in services, again, the upstream is only 17% and the downstream in services, 83%. And here you see the breakdown from different parts of the solar value chain, as well as the gross value added in the downstream services sector. Here I've broken down in two slides how we look at the solar value chain with inside the company in a condensed way. Vina had showed a much more detailed version of the entire solar value chain across different technologies. And what I've done here is I've listed the countries that are right now the most competitive manufacturers on the good side. You can see there is a clear dominance by China when it comes to manufacturing these components, whether it be polysilicon as a raw material, which comes from sand, manufacturing equipment. There's a wide diversity of countries that are leading manufacturers in developing this equipment. Ingots, wafers, solar cells, and modules. And an important element here is that logistics are becoming, as a service, an ever-increasing part of the cost as the cost of producing solar drops. And so we can't forget that between every one of these steps in the value chain, there's a significant amount of trade, and logistics are absolutely key. And on the bottom, I would like to draw your attention to, this is where we see the environmental goods agreement coming into play, liberalizing this industry. And in the countries where there is today no anti-dumping, no anti-subsidy, no local content requirement, as elements of the solar trade wars, there's a strong benefit from the ITA because solar cells and modules have been duty exempt because of their role in the semiconductor value chain. And then if we shift to the downstream in the industry, from financing, project development, operations and maintenance, recycling, and the recovered materials market, these are generally local jobs. Financing may bring in global expertise, but ultimately it will be impacted locally. Project development is local, operations and maintenance are local. Local in terms of disassembly, and then very specialized mechanical recycling done by market leaders tends to be done in Europe with imported waste. And then lastly, 25 years later, our solar modules become ultimately the raw materials that they were originally forced from to be replaced into the recovered materials market. So in conclusion, I would say the EGA, TISA, and the ITA all have very important roles to play in their respective part of the solar value chain. Avoiding the clean tech trade wars that we have seen paralyzing both the solar and the wind industry, as well as we've seen a good deal in biofuels, are absolutely necessary for countries to be able to achieve their Paris objectives in a timely fashion, but also in an affordable fashion. Because trade protectionism is increasing the domestic costs of the clean energy transition for every one of your countries. And you're already affected by it today. The question is, how much more will be spent by taxpayers in order to invest and to pay for this transition? Services, we see, are an absolutely key piece of building this clean energy future, because every one of these installations need to be maintained from 25 to 30 years by qualified local staff. So we believe it's very important moving forward that as you conclude your negotiations in the next months, you look to including services, keeping your eye toward other agreements that support the full clean energy value chain, and making a living agreement, because our industry changes dramatically every few months, not every few decades, and we need your support in developing an agreement that's going to enable us in industry to build that future. So, thank you.
Thank you very much, Jody. Okay, so that has been a set of incredibly rich presentations.